Hi, Susan. How are you this morning?
I'm doing so well. It's great to visit with you and everyone virtually.
All right, thanks. I've got lots and lots of questions today, so I hope you might have answers to some of them, and I imagine you won't have answers to others, so let's get started. There was a crush all up and down the California coast this past weekend of folks who said, I don't want to be cooped up anymore, I'm going to the beach, and some of the beaches were just overwhelmed. Tell me what the county has heard, what feedback you've given, and what you think we should do next about this exodus of folks on the weekends to hang out at the beaches.
Well, I think, first of all, the rush to all of our regional parks should have been anticipated when we announced that parking would be free. So, and we've had 4 or 5 days of people being sheltered in place in their homes and away from schools. So it is very natural that families especially would want to give their children an experience out of doors, as the perception is it's the healthy place to be, both physically and emotionally and spiritually. And whoa, what a crush of people we experience along the coast and in other regional parks and state parks as well. I took a hike at Annandale and I saw maybe 2 people yesterday, but I understand the parking lots at the state parks were full yesterday or Saturday as well. So the county is very concerned about this. And I think the most important message that I can convey is sheltering in place means exactly that. The more that you get in your car for joyrides or certainly frequenting faraway regional parks or state parks, the more exposure you provide for yourself, your families, and certainly for others. We've learned from other nations that as soon as they relaxed the sheltering in place order, that the rise in COVID started to increase again. So the message, and it's not just our regional parks, it is I'm very concerned about the folks accessing shopping with their entire family at Target and Walmart and Costco and Home Depot. And we're trying to figure out a sensible way of doing this to provide some educational physical enrichment. The advice that I can give to you is get your bicycles out of the garage, take a family bike ride a couple blocks or more. Don't expect restaurants to be open. You may have some fast food restaurants, but limit your physical activity to the area around your house, the area that you can walk and bicycle to. Please do not get in the car. Take your travel trailer somewhere else. This is the worst possible thing that you can do.
Okay, Susan, are the parks considering any movement so that to say limiting folks' access to the beaches or closing those beaches?
Well, sadly, Marin County closed all of their state, local, and national parks in Marin County because they were experiencing the same thing. I hate to think that we're going to be doing that, but what kind of provisions can we make to limit the number of folks in a park at any one time? And recognizing that some of the activities that we engage in our parks, like, for example, children's playgrounds, may not be the wisest choice unless you want to run around and disinfect all of the climbing apparatus.
Sure.
Don't think you want to do that. So we'll be issuing more advisories as the days go on, but the board and I and regional parks are very concerned about what this means for the safety of our community.
Sure. Let's jump now to personal protective equipment. Tell me if I'm wrong, but I believe I saw that the county itself was asking the community to donate personal protective equipment, or what they are now calling PPE. Of course, the medical folks have called it that all along.
Yes.
Tell me about the initiative for the county to get involved in something that the state and federal government should really have their eyes on.
I think our state and federal government should have ramped up production of the masks and ventilators and swabs and test kits long before they galvanized into action most recently. But here we are. We are county prepared. Many of us do have those masks, the N95 masks, because we've weathered through several disasters with our fires and smoke enveloping our community. So if you are like me, you have a little package of masks hidden in your closet or your car somewhere or your go bags. We really want a protective of devices in the original packaging. We want to make sure that they are new and safe. Please, we want them to the Salvation Army at 93 Stony Point Circle. And I think there'll probably be someone standing out front. But if you have gowns, nitrile gloves, anything that you could help our healthcare providers and our first responders be prepared for, please donate them because we need you coming forward now.
Sure, but my understanding, Susan, and please stop me if I'm wrong, is that what's really asked for is not simply if you have a mask or two lying around, but if you're a company who provides hundreds or thousands of these to your construction workers or to your factory workers, or if you are an organization that has stockpiled these, this is really what you want, is the kind of wholesale rather than the retail one-offs.
Absolutely. And we really want to thank all of our Freedmans and Home Depot and Keysight for stepping forward and recognizing that we are in an emergency situation. So unload those shelves and donate them to the desperately needed supplies for our first responders.
Okay, thanks so much. Now, Susan, tell me, here you are doing your county business from your home. I imagine some very, very high percentage of county workers are doing that. Is the county really prepared to have its workers work from home?
Well, our information systems department is on overdrive. They are trying to enable all of the electronic devices for us. And they were helpful in helping me to set up my iPad for the WebEx. Hey, we're going to try the brave new world of holding a board meeting tomorrow through WebEx. If you, and one of the items, we will be having a briefing on the COVID crisis that we are experiencing and have an opportunity, I think for the first time, for the board members to comment, because all of us have been on the phone talking with various sectors of the community, trying to identify what the needs are. But immediately after that, we will be perhaps recommending, but certainly reviewing an emergency ordinance for waivers or moratoriums of eviction notices.
That's exactly what's going to be my next question, yes. Susan. So let's deep dive into that. I asked you that last week. There was not a good answer as far as I was concerned. So I really want to hear this. Please, I'll shut up. Go ahead.
Well, I think last week was a little premature. Our county council was busy talking with all of the city attorneys and county councils throughout the state. I would have preferred this to happen at the state level rather than city by city and county by county. But here we are. And while we're talking, go on to the information. But I do believe it may be in effect during our emergency declaration period. But here's the key to the public. And I've had probably 5 to 25 different emails each day asking for this. I do know that some landlords are appreciably concerned about this. What does that mean for their security of their home? Are they going to lose their home and then therefore someone would be out of lunch or out of the home due to evictions? Lots of questions to be asked for sure. But the most important point is we recognize that so many of our minimally paid employees are paycheck by paycheck, really nervous about being evicted from their home. We're already struggling to try to identify places for safe distancing for our homeless population. We do not want to add to that crush. So we're on it, but we're not going to be having a public meeting, so you can't come to the board meeting. Please email, or you can record your public comment on any of the items by 5 p.m. tonight.
This is Monday night you're talking?
Monday night, 5 p.m. Monday night, for our board meeting that starts at 10 o'clock virtually throughout the county. And I believe, there's nothing to televise live because we're going to be having a virtual meeting, including reporting. It's very important for you to review the item on the board meeting agenda electronically. If you have a comment, you can record your comment up to 2 minutes. And, or if you have an email, please send an email to the clerk of the board. You can access all of that information on our website. We will be hearing those recorded messages during our virtual board meeting, and our clerk will be forwarding the public comments or questions that emailed to her to us. So it's going to be a little cumbersome, and we're trying to expedite our normal business during consent calendar so that we can just really focus on a few regular items, including the update on COVID and the emergency eviction action that we may be taking.
Okay, so if you don't mind, let's one more time go into what that emergency eviction action could be. And if you need to read it, or that would be fine. But I think this is really key for so many people in the county whose income has been shut off and who are afraid of being out on the streets.
Absolutely. So let me review on the website. It does have the text, the summary, the ordinance itself. Let's go to the summary rather than the whereases. And I'm going to put my glasses on. No, I can pull it up. Okay, it creates an affirmative defense for any residential tenant who can demonstrate that they have received a notice of eviction or failure to pay rent, and that such failure is related to a substantial loss of income or substantial out-of-pocket medical expenses resulting from the novel coronavirus pandemic. Its urgency ordinance also provides for a tenant who utilizes this defense, share that information with the owner of the property to support an owner's claim for any prospective mortgage relief due to impacts resulting from the coronavirus pandemic. And again, it's designed to facilitate the implementation of the governor's and public health officers' orders to shelter in place and to reduce additional instability in our community.
That's fabulous, Susan. That's really great. This, I think, is probably the most important thing that the board will do tomorrow. From my point of view, it will immediately make people feel like I'm not going to get kicked out of my home. And that's fabulous. Now, you know, they talk about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Perhaps you know about this. So shelter is one of them. Food is another. If I've lost my job, I wonder, how can I feed myself and my family? What is the county doing and thinking about that?
Interestingly, most people don't know what a web of activity is occurring in the Emergency Operations Center. We have a team working on food security. We have involved the Redwood Empire Food Bank, CERES, SCO, the Sonoma County Office of Education, linking into local efforts and service providers, distribution of food countywide. I know in Sonoma Valley, a group of great organizations have been meeting for the past week to develop what that would look like in Sonoma Valley, linking in the Senior Center, La Luz Center, and the brown baggers and homeless service providers of SOS. So check in with your local area to see what's happening locally.
But know that, where would you start, Susan?
Well, I think if you live in the River area, you know what the social service providers are.
If you live in Sebastopol, you go to your job every day. You've never had to do this before.
And that may be true. Let's see. I might have to get back to you on that, how you link into all of the distribution networks that are being set up as we speak. But know that at the top, we are organizing, linking out to all of those organizations. And it reminds me that on our website, and perhaps I've asked for a different website, linking all of the volunteer activities, and we desperately need volunteers, organizations, funding, the Community Foundation. A lot of independent funds are being raised to support these activities. So we hope to get as many much of that as possible onto our website so that you know what the distribution system is and how to link into it. But the county is on it and coordinating it, as well as the team working on homeless services, working with our healthcare providers on hospital surge capacity if need be. So we are working remotely, but we are working collaboratively, reaching out far and wide throughout the community.
Beautiful. And I imagine socoemergency.org would probably connect you with most of this.
Absolutely. And as of Monday morning, it appears that we still only have one death, sadly, tragically. But the number of cases actually have not ticked up as high as I thought they were. I think they're about 26, 27 cases, maybe a little higher than that. But we are rapidly going through our test kits, and I think we've tested over 500 different individuals. And so and I know that people are concerned about not being tested. Let me just tell you, if you are young and relatively healthy and you experience symptoms of flu or potentially COVID, you may not be referred for testing. We really want to save the tests and especially the laboratory space for those who are critically ill, who may have underlying medical conditions, and more than likely experiencing severe illness will be admitted into a hospital. Other folks may, like me, I do not have symptoms, but I'm sheltering in place, and many are self-caring in their homes with their families.
All right. I think, can you and I agree the fact that in a perfect world, it may have been better, it may be better to test everyone so we know where all these quiet cases are, but simply since we don't have the capacity, we are, in a sense, as a society, still needing to ration the tests. Would that be a fair statement?
I think it would be a fair statement, and I do understand people's concerns, especially those who asked for tests and were denied the capacity to be tested, or those who were tested and are frantically trying to find the results of their tests. But please understand, we are doing the best we can. In my perfect world, our nation would have responded and looked more carefully about what is happening globally. Internationally and started ramping up production of testing kits and medical equipment. But here we have it, and we're going to get through this, so don't panic. We're actually on the beginning and doing great things on self-containment.
Okay, Susan, finally, I have a question that's kind of looking out into the summer and fall. And usually a journalist would like to know the answer to the question before they ask. I have no idea what you're going to say, but it has occurred to me over the past few days that I was hoping that someone at the county in the emergency management department was looking forward to fire season and to figure out if we are in a situation analogous to the situation we are in now, what happens if a fire comes into our community as it has for every year, the last 3 years?
About a month ago, I was thinking exactly along those lines. I was very nervous about our non-existent rain in the month of February and witnessing our ground drying up before our very eyes and thinking, oh, we are in for another extreme fire season. And although that is still present in my mind, what I'm really focusing on is messaging to the community that be strong, we can deal with this just as many nations and cities and states are dealing with this. And I hope in my crystal ball that we will be on the other side of the pandemic. We'll be a little freer. Maybe we will be going back to school and going back to work. But other folks are saying that we may be in this for a while, in which case now is a great time to trim those bushes and shrubs around your house. And I know that our first responders from the firefighter world are already reviewing what is happening in our communities. And if you could arrange fire safe councils virtually, you don't have to meet in order to reach out, connect with your neighbors, and prepare for those emergencies, whether it's a pandemic, checking in on your neighbors about their health, or figuring out what you could do as a neighborhood to reduce the urgency and increase the preparation for fire.
Okay, but just to repeat, what was the underlying question behind what I was asking? Is there, to your knowledge, a working group who is on the county level who is looking forward to the possible collision of these two events, the coronavirus and possible ramping up during fire season?
To my knowledge, there is not that coordination yet, but it's a good question to have. We've received a first email from Fitch Mountain concerning expressing concern about this. So I think it is the natural next step of what if the pandemic exceeds longer than what we hope, and how will we work together to combat the fires that may set out. I know PG&E has been hard at work at strengthening the grid. Hopefully we minimize our disruptions to our grid system, because how in the world can we communicate with each other on our broadbands if in fact our systems are shut down? So this is new, and it's far-reaching and is multidimensional. So we'll work on that, and probably soon.
All right, Susan, finally, before we go, was there something you had hoped to talk about or to share with our community that we haven't been able to talk about this morning?
I want to just try to calm our community that, in fact, our cities and our county are working very closely together. The mayors and the supervisors are working very closely together, along with our school board members. Every level of government is in communication and discussing the what ifs. And even more importantly, how do we really support the social safety net for those many folks who may need meals during the day, whether they are seniors or school children, or may need outreach to healthcare providers. We are trying to explore all possibilities of collaboration and expanding the reach of organization to understand what the needs are. But if you anticipate or think of some needs that we may not have discussed, please send us an email and we'd be glad to forward them on and answer your questions. And I will say, I've been receiving a lot of emails from folks very concerned about that property tax deadline of April 10th. Yep. And just for their information, this extension or moratorium waiver comes from the state level. We do not have the ability to waive that locally. And I know that in the worst possible time with people out of work, they're worried about paying their property taxes, but we will be having future conversations with the state. Our auditor, controller, tax collector has been hard at work and details will emerge, but I wish we could simply wave the magic wand and extend that deadline, and sadly we cannot.
All right, Susan Gorin, Chair of the Board of Supervisors, thanks for all you're doing, and thanks for being so available to chat this morning.
Thanks, Steve. I look forward to our next opportunity.
All right, so long.